Hello and welcome to My Secret Math Tutor. In this video, we're going to take on tabular integration. And if you've never seen this technique before, I think you're in for quite a treat. Let's talk a little bit more about it. Tabular integration is really just an organized way of doing integration by parts. So if you're not familiar with that method or you're not really quite sure what I'm talking about, check out my other video on what integration by parts is and how to do it. Now, since it really is integration by parts, it really shines for those problems where you have to do integration by parts multiple times. There are a few problems where you might have to do it over and over again, and this table really allows you to take all that information and organize it and be able to spit out an answer very fast. Now, it also happens to work for integrals that repeat themselves when doing integration by parts. These tend to be some very frustrating integrals, but this method still works just fine for them. And of course, the really interesting part is since it really is just integration by parts in the background, you can use this for any time you need to do integration by parts, and you can stop it at any time, which really just gives you a simpler integral than what you started with. All right, so that's enough talking about this method. Let's go ahead and give it a try. All right, in this first problem, we're just going to get a feel of how the method works. And when doing integration by parts, the first key step is identifying a piece where you can take the derivative, maybe something like this x cubed, and another piece where you can easily take the antiderivative, like e to the x. Now what we're going to do with each of these pieces is we're going to put them into our table. So the derivative piece will go onto the left side here, so e cubed, or x cubed, and the antiderivative piece, the piece where we want to take the antiderivative, will go on the right side. And just to keep these two organized, and so I remember which is which, I'm going to write a little d over dx on the left column. I'm going to put a little integral symbol on the right column. That way I know I should be taking derivatives on this side, antiderivatives over here. All right, let's go ahead and work on that left side. Like I said, we're just going to start taking derivatives. So the derivative of x cubed is 3x squared. The derivative of 3x squared is 6x. The derivative of 6x is 6. And the derivative of 6 goes to 0. So I've simply just taken a bunch of derivatives. On the other side, we're going to take antiderivatives. So we want to think backwards. Antiderivative of e to the x is e to the x, so that's nice. And it looks like it's just the same since the antiderivative of that is also e to the x. And all the way down. Now, I only want to do as many rows as I have rows over here. So since this went off to 0, I'll go ahead and stop it at that last row right there. I won't necessarily continue going on. All right, so this table has all of the information we really need for writing down our answer. We just now have to collect it out of there. How should we do that? Well, we're going to connect the left column with the right column, but we're going to do it along a diagonal. So x cubed, I'll connect it with e to the x over here. 3x squared, I'll connect it to this one over here. I'll keep connecting them along that diagonal until I've run out of terms. Now there's nothing left. You'll see why I'm not too worried about that 0 when we start getting into a little bit later. Now that I have how these are connected, we want to see what sign they're connected with. The first two are connected with a plus sign, and the next two are connected with a minus sign. And you want to keep alternating as you go down the table. So plus, minus, plus, minus. Let's go ahead and put those in. Plus, minus, plus, minus. All right. Now it's time to write down our answer. Here's how we do that. We take our pieces that are connected, so in this case the x cubed and the e to the x, and we write them down. We put the sign in front that corresponds to the sign of how they're connected. So in this case, these, I could imagine like a little plus sign out front, but I'm not going to go ahead and write that. On to the next piece. 3x squared and e to the x. Yep, that's how those are connected, and they're connected with a minus sign. Next pieces. I have a 6x and e to the x. These are connected with a plus sign. And the last two, 6 and e to the x, oops. These are connected with a minus sign. All right, and there's our answer. As long as we remember to include the nice little plus c on the end, and we're done. Now, notice how we essentially did integration by parts. This was the u and the dv piece. We just did it over and over, and this table helped us keep track of that so we could immediately jump to the answer. Let's look at a different problem and see how this works one more time. All right, like before, we want to identify the piece where we need to take derivatives. And that's going to be this piece here, since if I take derivatives long enough, it will also eventually go to 0. The other piece, we want to think of taking its antiderivative. This will not zero out, but you know, those trigonometric functions, they tend to cycle back, so I think we'll be okay. All right, let's write down these pieces. They become the first row in our table. And away we go. Taking derivatives. The derivative of 2x squared will be 4x. The derivative of 4x goes to 4. And the derivative of 4 is simply 0. So this one zeroed out again. Off on the right side here, time to take antiderivatives. So we have to think carefully. All right, what is the antiderivative of cosine? Well, that goes to sine. Antiderivative of sine, negative cosine. And the antiderivative of negative cosine, negative sine. Now that we have those, connect them along the diagonal. And now we can write down the signs of how they're connected. Remember, these start with plus, but then they alternate. So you'll go plus, minus, plus, all the way down until you've run out of stuff. All right, that looks good. Now let's go ahead and write down what we have. So the first two pieces here, looks like we have a 2x squared plus 1 multiplied by a sine of x. Plus sign in front, looks good. Next two pieces, 4x multiplied by a negative cosine of x. And these are connected with a minus sign, so minus. And the last two pieces here, looks like we have a 4 and a negative sine of x connected with a plus sign. All right, now technically that is our answer, but it's always nice to take an additional step and connect these double negative signs in there. So let's see, 2x squared plus 1 multiplied by sine of x. Negative times a negative will give us a positive, so 4x cosine of x minus 4 sine of x. Put on our little plus c, and now this guy is done. Now this technique does work good even if your integral tends to repeat itself. Let's go ahead and see what that would look like using this technique. All right, so as before, we want to identify pieces where we can take the derivative and antiderivative, and in this particular integral, it doesn't really matter which one we're going to choose for derivative or antiderivative, so let's go ahead and just choose e to the 2x for our derivative piece, and we'll choose sine of x for the piece where we will take antiderivatives. All right, into our table. So I have e to the 2x, and I have sine of x. Right, so on the left side, it's time to take some derivatives. Derivative here, using our chain rule, is 2e to the 2x. Now I'm thinking of the derivative of this, and again, I'm using the chain rule, so I'll get 4e to the 2x. And the derivative of, again, bring down that 2, let's see, 8e to the 2x. And you can see this one is not zeroing out. If I were to continue this process, it just keeps going over and over. So let's see, let's do one more time, 16e to the 2x. Dot, 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 keeps going. All right, onto the right side. For the right side, we're doing antiderivatives. So the antiderivative of sine is negative cosine. The antiderivative of negative cosine, now we're at negative sine. Antiderivative of that, cosine of x. And the antiderivative of cosine, sine. And of course, this would also continue if we really were feeling ambitious. Now, what you want to do in this case is comb over your table and look for two pieces next to each other that involve your e to the 2x and your sine of x. Of course, it'll be the first row on the table, but we're looking at for the very next instance that has those two pieces. Now, it doesn't matter if they have constants in front of them. We really, again, just want the e to the 2x and the sine of x. And we can see that that happens right here in the third row. Here's my e to the 2x. And there's my sine of x. Yes, they have a 4 and a negative sign, but I'm not really too worried about those. We'll be just fine. So I'm drawing this dotted line here, and what that means is I'm going to stop this process after that point. I'm not really worried about anything that comes after it. All right, time to connect our pieces. Like before, we will connect along the diagonal. And when we get to this last one, I don't really want to cross this dotted line, so I'm going to connect things straight across. This one's kind of a special one. Watch what I do with this one when I start writing out the answer. All right, so we have our connections. We want to connect them using plus. The other one is minus and plus. Excellent. Now it's time to write down what we have, see where we can go from there. So the first two pieces, I have an e to the 2x multiplied by a negative cosine of x. Of course, those are connected with a little plus sign out front. That's good. Next two pieces, 2 e to the 2x connected with a negative sign. These are connected with a negative sign, so let's go ahead and put that in. And now the last two pieces, this is that special one. We still have them. So I have a 4 e to the 2x, and I have a negative sign. Notice how I'm not connecting these along the diagonal. I'm connecting them straight across. These are special because they are inside of an integral. We've stopped the process early, so these ones are not quite done yet. And out in front of that integral, we will put a plus sign. So we do have something a little bit simpler than what we started with, and of course we're choosing this example because it has the similar piece on the inside. Let's go ahead and simplify our signs and see exactly what's going on. So let's see, let's move that negative sign out front. Negative times a negative will give us a positive. Here I'll move out the negative sign and we'll also move out that 4. So I'll have a negative 4 e to the 2x sine of x dx. And now you can really see it. That integral on the right side there is exactly the same as what we started with. But that's okay. Since it is the same, I can go ahead and combine it together with my original integral on the left side and we'll be all right. So here's my original. Here I have subtracting 4 of them. We'll add 4 to the right side and we'll add 4 to the left side. Let's see, there's only one of them over here. So 4 plus 1 will give us 5 of our original integral. All right, that will take that one, put it over here. Everything else is exactly the same. And now we are almost home free. The last step of this really is just divide by 5. And now we can see the value of the integral we were originally interested in. So there's our original integral, everything divided by 5. So I have a negative 1/5 e to the 2x cosine of x plus a 2/5 e to the 2x sine of x. And of course, don't forget our plus c. Now it's just one last example to show you that you can really use this for any problem that uses integration by parts. Let's take care of this one. This one involves an x to the 3/2 multiplied by a natural log of x. So if you were to try and do derivatives and antiderivatives, none of these really cancel out or go to zero, so we're going to have to stop that process early. Also, none of these necessarily cycle back on themselves like trigonometric functions will, so watch why I stop it early and why it really does help us. All right, so I need a piece to take derivatives of. And in this particular problem, it's nicest to take derivatives of natural log. That's because its derivative is just 1 over x. In terms of antiderivatives, we'll take antiderivatives of x to the 3/2. All right, so we've identified our pieces. Let's go ahead and put them into our table. There they are. So on the left side here, let's start taking derivatives. Derivative of natural log is 1 over x. Or since we'll be taking lots of derivatives, we could write this as x to the negative 1. All right, another derivative would bring down that negative 1, reduce the power, so I have negative x to the negative 2. Another derivative, these would multiply, so I had 2x to the negative 3. All right, and of course this continues on, but we'll go ahead and at least do a few. All right, antiderivative over here. We want to think of adding 1 to the power and then dividing by that new power. Of course, when we divide by a fraction, we want to flip and multiply, so we'll get 2/5 x to the 5/2. Let's do another antiderivative. So add 1 to the power, divide by that fraction, so the same as flipping and multiplying. That'd be 4 35ths. And one more antiderivative just for good measure. So there's that 9/2. Imagine flipping that over, multiplying it by 4/5. We'd get 8 all divided by 315. All right, even though this is neither side is going towards 0, I can see that if I were to stop this, what two pieces might be put together. So after this, the second row here, if I were to put the x to the negative 1 with the x to the 5/2, I'd only be left with x's inside of my integral, and that's actually a pretty good place to stop. So let's go ahead and put in our dotted line right here to show that I'll only be really needing this table for the first two rows. We'll connect them along the diagonal. And since I have my dotted line, we'll just connect these straight across. So in a way, this is like doing integration by parts only once. So there's my plus sign. And there's my minus sign. All right, let's write out what we have. So the first part, I'll have the natural log of x multiplied by a 2/5 x to the 5/2. Next two pieces here, these will end up inside of an integral, and we'll subtract the integral away. That's because of this negative sign here, and of course we're connecting them across. So let's see, x to the negative 1 multiplied by 2/5 x to the 5/2. All right, excellent. So I started with this integral, we have something a little bit nicer, now we just have to clean everything up. Let's go ahead and rearrange the order of these. I don't want anyone else to think that maybe this is inside of my natural log. It is not. So let's see. We have 2/5 x to the 5/2 natural log of x minus combining these on the inside. Let's take out that 2/5. We'll get x to the 3/2. All right, and of course, that's a perfectly nice integral. We can take the antiderivative of that with no problems. So let's go ahead and do just that. The antiderivative of x to the 3/2, we would add 1 to the power, so 5/2, divide by that new power, 2/5. And we'll go ahead and put a plus c on it right there. All right, let's go ahead and clean it up in just one more step. And then I think this one is great. So we have 2/5 x to the 5/2. Natural log of x minus 4/25 x to the 5/2 plus c. And then it's done. So hopefully that helps you out and you learn a brand new technique for taking care of integration by parts, one that really organizes your information in a much better way. If you'd like to see more videos, please visit my website at mysecretmathtutor.com. Thanks again.